Hello. Here we are on July 3rd. Get a little bit better light here. See which one's going to look better for me. I'm not an expert at making videos, but I do know that if you've got the right light, it's a little bit better to see the image. Anyways, I've come to you today, another day in the bright light that we're all given here. The opportunities we are afforded are endless with the amount of information that we have the capacity to attain. It's simply a matter of using these things and going down to the library and start flipping the page of a book, or to get on the internet and start doing a little bit of research on your own. The reflection on the glasses is always a bit of a pain to people, but I like to be able to see what I'm doing. So I apologize to those people that don't like the reflection in the glasses. Today I'm going to try and get down to the beginnings of what has caused me to teach the things that I teach, feel the way I feel, have that inner urge to expose things. What causes me to want to do that? What's my motive for doing these things? There are people that work within the Justice Department of the Canadian federal government and the provincial government. They work with the RCMP, National Security Intelligence. They work with CSIS. They work with the police, Commercial Crimes Unit. They work with the province's Human Services. They work with the Premier's Office, and they're all assigned to protect and defend the particular offices that they work for. All of those particular offices are assigned by risk management. Risk management is the team at the top that protects the various corporate entities from having claims put against them. They're certainly not there to protect the men and women of the country or the province. They're there to protect the insurance liability policies that the corporation known as Alberta, BC, or Canada has formed upon all of the men and women that are working in the public service. They are bonded for $1 million, and there's a $100,000 deductible. That means if they bring harm to any man or woman in the public as a result of their dealing with them, according to statute, code, and regulation, they can be claimed upon. And if the claim is successful, the insurance policy will pay for the claim. If it's their fault, it's a $100,000 deductible. So the reason that these men and women that work for risk management instruct the lawyers, and a lot of them are lawyers, is because they work for a major organization called the Crown. Now, the Crown is worldwide under the bar. All of them are lawyers that work under the Crown. And they are a business that makes money off of the sins of men and women that walk the earth. Now, when I say the sins, I don't mean to preach at you, but what I mean to tell you is that the whole system is set up under a Bible. Whether you go to Constantine's putting together of the Bible under the Council of Nicaea and the years afterwards where the books were put together, or you rely upon Martin Luther and the Protestant Reformation and the King James Bible, any of those that you rely upon, especially the King James Bible, are put up as to give you some kind of trust and security, some kind of hope, some answers for the problems that you're having with your life, the men and women around you, etc. Now, the reason that the King James Bible was used throughout the Commonwealth and is the leading instrument of standing within the Commonwealth judicial system is that men and women believing in Christ and believing the Bible put their faith in it so strongly that they're willing to give up their lives for it. And they certainly don't want to lose their souls by committing any kind of sin. So the Bible was used to entice them into giving trust to the men and women who acted as the kings and queens, the monarchs of the Commonwealth. for without some method of trusting these men and women instituting themselves as kings and queens, well, there would have been a lot of pitchforks and burning at the stake. So the trust was enabled through utilizing the Bible as that source of information and faith that men and women throughout the ages have submitted themselves to, and up to now and today, our present queen sitting on the throne, the crone sitting on the throne, certainly has the same methodology involved. The bait and switch program is in full activity. When I say bait and switch, I'm speaking of how I learned at an early age, being brought up as a Jehovah's Witness, that God's law was prime, and that the Bible was the word of God. And so I started reading it pretty closely as I was being trained in it, and I discovered in there that it said, don't add to God's law and don't take away from God's law. Well, I started asking questions about, well, how can the government add to God's law? Oh, well, Romans 13 says we're supposed to submit to the government. I said, well, that's nice. How did the government get to add to God's law? Well, as many times as I asked that question and watched the wrinkled up, concerned faces as they realized that they had goofed, messed up, missed the words of the book, and were actually teaching people to go and bow and submit to a false god, they looked pretty stupid. And a lot of these guys, full of their ego and their blasphemy, teaching people to bow down to false gods, got really mad at me. Oh, they got furious that I was using the Bible to show people that God said don't add to his law. And then by asking, well, then once God says that, so God's not a liar, well, then who gets to add to his law? Well, nobody does. So these people working at risk management for the government, they're awfully upset at me because I've exposed the oh-so-simple flaw in their hooga-booga, we're the government, bow down and submit to us network of fraud. You see, once it says nobody is to add to his law, in Deuteronomy 4:2, 12:32, and then it says in Leviticus 18:3-4, don't walk in the ordinance of the heathen. Well, if heathen made ordinance, well, they've added to God's law. They never had any authority to do that. So submitting to any of their codes is submitting to a false god, because people who make laws are saying, we're the rulers, you do what we say. If you don't, we got punishment for you. So as it turns out, all of the governments under the Christian monarchy today are false god governments, irrefutably, undeniably, and in reality smack you in the face of deliberate fraud. Now this is why I teach people this information, because my heart knows this is wrong. I was brought up with a moral conscience, aside from the rest of the men and women working for the snake charmers known as the world bankers, that believe that if you oppose fraud and you try to tell the truth about fraud, you're some kind of a terrorist, errorist, bad guy, and that the RCMP are told that they have to put out false notices about you, and judges are encouraged to write false decisions making false statements about you because the threat to that risk management and those liability bonds is a real threat. It's a staggering threat that they never ever figured would come to their door. They figured they'd be able to conduct their fraud and their scamming people forever. They figured nobody would be able to figure out that all they had to do was stand up and claim God and the Bible, and that nobody has the authority to intimidate you to stop believing in God and the Bible. Whether you're Catholic, Protestant, Sikh, Hindu, it doesn't really matter what particular faith you are. If you choose to say, well, I'm interested in this book over here, The Queen Defends, I'd like to start reading it. But before I start reading it, I'd like to know, do you have the authority to intimidate me or prevent me from practicing what laws God has put out here and following them explicitly? Do you have the authority to intimidate me to break the commands of God? Well, it's a really simple question, but like I've said, some of these people that work for the risk management and the Justice Department get extremely frustrated by simplicity. Their lives revolve around complexities, about deceptions, about the fraud that they are undergoing to continue. And this is why I teach people. This is why I go out on the road without reward, without any making any money, and I'll take my time and my life and effort to go through a great ordeal just to find somebody that is willing to take this knowledge and benefit from it. Now, what's unfortunate for me and the rest of the people that could use this information is that very few of the people that I approach are brave enough in the heart and strong enough in the spirit to continue learning and practicing this knowledge. The world is designed to make you give it up, make you forget, make you afraid, make you divisive and want to argue with the facts. Well, the hard part about arguing with the facts is it's like trying to fight yourself. You're not going to be very successful at trying to fight yourself other than frustrate yourself and end up in the same position that you started. So when you try to fight facts, you're trying to fight reality. It's like trying to fight your own reflection in the mirror and saying you don't like it. The facts are there. Whether you like it or not is irrelevant if those facts are influencing you and your family. And as it turns out, they are. The facts are that the government of the province of Alberta is running a religious fraud. They've put the Queen up there to give them their authority, who is a Christian monarch that swore to defend the laws of God with all of her power. In that book, it says God is no respecter of persons. Now, any men or women listening to this video might want to say, well, why is God saying he is no respecter of persons? I'm a person, and they think that openly, and they're free to think that if they wish. But they've never really accurately researched the word and find out where it got its origins. As it turns out, the persona was a mask used in the Greek amphitheaters worn by a player on the stage. The word person has come directly from the Greek word persona, or the Latin, which is also persona, which means a mask worn by a player on a stage. All modern law relies upon that same exact identical interpretation when the word person is used, because it is applied to a corporation. In the Canada Interpretation Act and many other enactments of the Commonwealth countries, you will find the definition of person is only including a corporation. Now, the reason I put that word only in front of the word including is because most people are unfamiliar that the word includes is a restrictive term, as well as the word excludes. They are restrictive by their very formation in the English language. The clued part in the in and the ex part in the clued are relative to one another because they are opposite. To include is to take one item that is mentioned after the word included, or two items or three items, and it is indeed included. All else is excluded. So when we read the definition in section 35 of the Interpretation Act for the word person, and all words used to describe a person includes a corporation. So we know that a mask worn by a player on a stage is exactly what a corporation does. It's a mask to hide the liability of those men and women that are operating behind that mask, trying to save themselves from the liability of their decisions by using a corporate mask up front to take on the liability so they can save themselves harmless for what they do in their private capacity and blame it on the corporation. It's a real cheap, fake way of getting away from being responsible for doing what you're doing, but that's what corporations do. That's what they are. They are dead in law. They have no life. They have no soul. And God has no respect for them. And he says in James 2 and 9, if I should show respect to them, I commit sin. Well, the province of Alberta and every courthouse formed as a corporation trading on the New York Stock Exchange is also a person. If men and women get accosted by police and charged for things where no man, woman, or property was harmed, like driving without a license, possession of marijuana, fishing without a license, etc., and the list goes on of victimless crimes into the tens of thousands of victimless crimes. As it turns out, if there's no harmed man, woman, or property, and you're not a person, and you can't show respect to persons, well, all of that corporate codified law does not apply to you. Section 176 of the Criminal Code of Canada specifically states that it's a criminal offense on the part of any government employee that works for that dead corporation to obstruct any man or woman from officially performing the functions of their calling. The bad thing for the public servant is there's no definition in law about what the functions of your calling are, except the King James Bible. Romans 11:29 provides us information where it says the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. So if you feel called by God to go do a good deed for somebody and you're in the process of doing that, you certainly can't be convicted of doing anything illegal, but anybody who dares to obstruct you in doing what's common to all of Her Majesty's subjects, such as practicing your Christian faith, is certainly in commission of violation of 176 of the Criminal Code, and I would say probably 180 of the Criminal Code as well. Remembering that this Criminal Code was meant for the fictional corporation entities that are siding up and masking themselves as corporations, as these various government officers that are taking up the role by private men and women. Private men and women take on these titles as officer this, or captain that, or sergeant that, or chief justice of this, or chief prosecutor of that. These are titles that are fraud, fake attempts to absolve themselves from the liability of intimidating you to violate your faith, whether it be newfound or not. You're allowed to take up your faith at any moment and ask somebody else, do they have the authority to intimidate you, to prevent you, and obstruct you from reading and practicing the directions of the King James Bible. Now, there are many people out there who have heard me and have listened to me that didn't have the faith. They didn't have the courage. They didn't have the gift of the Spirit to continue with the knowledge and proceed ahead. So they decided that rather than look bad, feel guilty, and appear to other people as if they didn't know what they were doing, we'll turn and try to point the finger at the messenger. This is a very old ploy. It's called shoot the messenger. It's caught up with the colloquialism of that phrase. Don't shoot the messenger. Well, the reason for that phrase, don't shoot the messenger, is the messenger is certainly not responsible for the message. He is only one delivering the message for you to examine to see if it's applicable to you, and if it is, well, then you can apply it to your benefit and to the benefit of others that you may know. And if it is not, well, then you simply say, this is not for me, I thank you very much, and the messenger can move on. But to spray bullets and rotten goods at the messenger and disseminate and disembowel the messenger, a murder, and send the body parts of the messenger around for others to laugh at, seems to do nothing to deny the message. It seems to do absolutely zero to erase that important information that the messenger was providing. Myself as the messenger provides the information that you simply, exercising your faith, cannot be compelled to submit to false god authority operating on a commercial capacity, primarily to steal your energy and your value. You see, we were all bonded at birth after April 10th, 1933, because that's when Canada went into formal receivership after the bankruptcy of 1930. This is popularly put up on websites and public archives of government's data and information that one can research and find out absolutely took place subsequent to the 1929 stock market crash, wherein the international bankers and their consortiums controlling the stock market rigged and effected a massive downslide of stocks and energy values to the point where the companies that were dependent upon this stock markets and the corporations known as governments went bankrupt. This was certainly not a mistake or a chance happening. It was planned. So men and women in that plan have the opportunity to pick up the King James Bible or any other holy book that they feel comfortable with and claim your faith. Let those men and women working in the government offices know in their private capacity, certainly not addressing them by their titles or using postal codes to write to them, Postal codes are evidence of engaged in commercial activity, and you can find this in 11.1 and 2 of the Canada Letter Mail Postal Regulations, which refer to the fact that if you're using a postage meter, you're engaged in commercial activity and must use the postal code, whereas if you're using nothing but a postage stamp, there is no requirement to use a postal code. That's because you are not engaged in commercial activity. So I hope some of you take note of the fact that the game that's afoot is whether you're charging money and requiring a certain amount of repayment for whatever you may do to help another man or woman. For if you're doing that, you're involved in ungodly service out for yourself, and you don't care about anybody else enough to take your time to help. That's certainly not walking in the footsteps of Christ or offering good faith service to men and women for free. If you're doing that, you're engaged in ministry, and their authority over you ceases because you're not acting in the capacity of a person. You're acting in the capacity as a man, a minister of God, delivering good works to those who may be in need. You see, the Risk Management Department and the Justice Department, they don't like people being able to classify themselves as ministers because it threatens their livelihood, it threatens their existence of business, of having the poor suckers that don't know the truth about this fraud submit themselves, because the more people that find out the truth, all you need is your faith and a Bible to escape the fraud, well, the more people are going to line up and the justice system will start to fail. And they don't want to lose business, so their business depends upon deceiving people. So they will continue to deceive men and women to believe that they have to submit and bow down to a false god. They will rumble Romans 13 at you and try and shove 2 Peter 2 or 1 Peter 2:13 down your throat, trying to imply that God contradicts himself and allowed people to add to his law and allowed people to bow down to guys who said that they were God, like Caesar, and even imply that Christ paid taxes to Caesar by utilizing render under Caesar that which is Caesar and render under God that which is God's as their primary phrase, or using the example of Peter telling the tax collectors from Capernaum's Hebrew temple that their master paid the tax. Immediately Peter reduced him back to his worldly name of Simon, saying, "What thinkest thou?" and told him to go down to the ocean and catch a fish, where a certain coin was in the fish's mouth. Well, it wasn't a denarius or denarii, which a Roman tax was paid in with Caesar's picture on it, but in fact it was a shekel, 2/5 of an ounce of silver, which was enough to pay for two men for the temple tax, for Christ said, "Go pay them the tax for thee and thy." So it's clear when we research the money, it is the same kind of money that Christ held up after he held up the Roman coin and said, "Rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's." For if you're using a false god's money, a guy who jumps up on a pedestal and says, "I'm God, the whole world shall worship me and pay me taxes," well, it's very difficult for anybody to say, "Well, Caesar wasn't a false god." They're looking very contradictory and foolish and even trying to convince you of that when Caesar himself told the whole world he was God. Christ knows that the third commandment, don't bow down to false gods and don't serve them, is quite clear. If Caesar is claiming he's God, well, then he's a false god by the evidence right there on the face of it. So when the coin was brought up and it had the image of Caesar in it, again in contravention of the commandment, "Thou shalt put no images before me," well, Christ quite accurately said, if you're going to use Caesar's money, then you better rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's. You got yourself a new god you're worshiping by using his money. You're showing him respect. Whereas if you're going to use God's money, and he holds up the shekel that you can't see in the rendering of the verse, says, "Rend under God that which is God's." Well, that silver shekel had God's name on it. It was commanded by God. That was the money of the temple, and taxes were to be paid in that money. So certainly we had a choice. We could respect God and his money system by using it and clinging fast, or we could go and bow to a false god, Caesar, and start using his money. And as Christ accurately told us, "Rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's, and rend under God that which is God's." So if you're going to submit to a false god and use his money, then you've got to render it under him. But if you're not submitting to a false god and not using their money, well, then you don't have to pay them. You only use God's money. So that attempts to settle the problem with the people have with Romans 13 and rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's. But 1 Timothy 2:13 is quite relative as well, because it says, submit yourself to the ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. Well, yeah, we're supposed to submit ourselves to the ordinance of man written for the Lord's sake. All those ordinances of man that are written for the Lord's sake are the ones that we are supposed to follow. No murder, no theft, no killing, no adultery, no bearing false witness. These are all part of man's law. They were written for the Lord's sake, and we are supposed to submit ourselves to those laws, but certainly not any other law, otherwise we'd be violating the commandment. God told us, don't bow to false gods. He said, don't add to my law. This I command you. It's very important to keep that in mind, otherwise you have to explain the contradiction of why God would tell people don't add to his law, and then go and tell people to submit to them that did add to his law. Well, of course, that's an oxymoron of the greatest magnitude, and it does not fit with the Bible. So certainly the other option is that we are submit ourselves to the ordinances of man that are written for the Lord's sake. Makes perfect sense. That's logical and is supportable with the Scripture. What is also supportable with the Scripture is that you only have to ask and ye shall receive. If you're asking for freedom from a false god system, do not give up and continue asking fervently and diligently. Eventually, these men and women acting as false oath lawyers will have to concede the fact that you do not represent a threat or any harm will come to any of them or any of their government agencies by respecting your faith and beliefs and by leaving you out of their fraud. They certainly can't put forward any evidence that any man or woman or property is being harmed by you not being intimidated to participate in their fraud. So I thank you very much for your time, and this video should also be specially dedicated to Rachel Notley and Kathleen Ganley. Rachel Notley being our new Democratic government premier. She is putting Albertans in a position to have a lot to hope for after 40 years of dinosaurs ruling. We would hope that she would carry on the legacy of her father, Grant, who was a wonderful, startlingly, amazingly bright man, looking forward to the independence of men and women from slavery. And I'm hoping Rachel will be along those same lines. And I'm hoping her appointed and chosen Justice Minister, Kathleen Ganley, will not be lied to by justice participant lawyers and judges who are out for their own commercial gain, bleeding off the annuities of those men and women that come before them listed as persons and popping up their superannuation pension funds by having those annuities paid into them upon tariffs that have been applied by the prosecution and the court and the clerk of the court as well. These tariffs then being used to create securities with the men and women listed as the accused before the court, also listed as persons, are used as surety. And you can find evidence of that in the Canada Interpretation Act under the definition of the word security. I certainly hope that Kathleen Ganley and Rachel Notley have the opportunity to find out that men and women are being used as they are unaware of how the government is using them for surety to create securities. Every time you see that word security in any Canadian governmental legislation means one person has been used for surety. And the definition is unequivocal and irrefutable there in the Interpretation Act in Section 35. So I hope that Kathleen Ganley and Rachel Notley will take the time and the good advice on my part to examine those sections and find out whether or not I'm huffing and puffing a bunch of fraudulent lies and deceiving people, or I am telling the truth, and it is the lying lawyers working for the Justice Department under the cloak of a false oath that are the ones that are deceiving the populace of Alberta. They certainly don't want the Albertans to find out that every single man or woman that's listed as a resident within the province has their annuities are transferred over from the federal government annually. That annuity transfer allows the provincial government to then bill every man, woman, and child that is listed there in the Consolidated General Revenue Fund for any of the activities that the provincial government wishes to engage upon. It is their funds, and they will assign those funds to various agencies as contractors for the Annuity Act. The Annuity Act of Canada allows the Government of Canada, who acts as the main trustee over these annuities, to transfer the trust to other contractors, such as men and women that work in health services or men and women that work in human services. They're bleeding off of these annuity accounts. That is how the government is being funded. We have no gold in the Bank of Canada. I hope you're paying attention, Kathleen Ganley. There is no gold that gives any value to the paper dollar. It is valued off the flesh of men and women who have been bonded as valuable commodities and as beneficially owned property. You can find this in the definitions of the Canadian Ownership Control and Determination Act, and you can find this in the 1984 regulations of the Canadian Ownership and Control Determination Act Schedule 2. I do hope that you take the time to look up the law that applies to you as somebody who has submitted themselves to work for an agency that is a corporation dead in law with no soul, that is at present attempting to intimidate private men and women to violate their faith and beliefs in the King James Bible, Jesus Christ, and their ability to practice those faith and beliefs unmolested. I hope that you're taking note of this, because I presently am being obstructed, molested, nuisanced, and damaged by those justice participant lawyers working under you, Kathleen Ganley. So I hope that your boss, Rachel Notley, will take the time to investigate, because I'm saying there's a fraud taking place where your Justice Department lawyers are getting paid by my annuities to intimidate me from practicing my faith, to obstruct me from practicing my faith, and acting as a nuisance deliberately, trying to prevent me from doing what's common to all of Her Majesty's subjects, which makes me feel extremely uncomfortable. You have taken away my ability to approach and attach my annuities that would allow me to live comfortably and adequately. You're in violation of your international accords called the United Nations Human Rights Act and all the resolutions contained therein about the enactment to eliminate intolerance of religious beliefs and the enactment for the rights of civil and political men and women that wish to enact those civil and political freedoms. You're interfering deliberately by taking the word of false oath Justice Department lawyers and judges over your own diligent mind and ability to determine what the truth is, by trusting other men and women that are obviously engaged in a fraud, by adding to God's law and telling other men and women they have to submit to it. You're bringing yourself into the fraudulent activity and even encroaching upon treason, which is attempting to overthrow Her Majesty's government, which is certainly not a bunch of men and women sitting in Parliament. It is the King James Bible itself. If you don't believe that, you can read the Archbishop's words in the ceremony of 1953 that you can find on oramus.org, up on the website where the whole coronation ceremony of 1953 is printed. You can see the Archbishop presented the Holy Bible as the lively oracles of God, the most valuable thing this world affords for the life and government and rule of Christian princes. So we know what the rule of law is at the beginning of the charter that most of you men and women listening to this video have reviewed at one time or another. Whereas Canada is founded upon the principles that recognize the supremacy of God and the rule of law. Well, those principles can hardly stray from the fact that it is founded under a Christian monarchy that recognizes God as the commandment giver and no other. Certainly they cannot claim that they're under a Christian monarchy and then claim they get to add to God's law in violation of what He says. But that's exactly what your Justice Department lawyers are doing, Kathleen Ganley. That's exactly what those men and women acting as Justice Department participants are doing, Rachel Notley. They're violating their own false oaths. I don't know how you violate a false oath, but they're violating all honor and integrity, pulling off a complete fraud and a scam, and they're doing it with your approval. Now that you're aware and with knowledge a fraud is taking place, I do believe the liability is upon you to rectify this fraud. and reduce the liability that you are incurring upon yourselves and your cabinet as men and women. For certainly there will be no way in no manner anybody will be able to substantiate where they got any authority to intimidate myself or any other man or woman wishing to establish their faith in Christ and following the words contained in the King James Bible Her Majesty so dutifully swore to defend. So I thank you very much for your time, and again I will continually articulate these facts to you in my inordinate desire to ensure that men and women that are being subjected to this fraud can be freed from this fraud and have the free choice to live their lives under their own steam with their own value, free from the extortion racket that is presently holding that value and using it for surety. So I thank you so much for your time, and I hope that this may have explained a few more things to the men and women that watch my channel. I'm sorry that a lot of my videos were of such a poor quality. Some of you have complained. I continue to try and improve and get better. I don't use any script when I make my videos, so a lot of the things I say are in repetition. They're over and over and over because there's a very strong program out there that makes people believe they're supposed to bow to these false god governments, and they're supposed to submit, and that they get to lawfully intimidate you to violate your faith, when nothing could be further from the truth. There is no power in any man or woman on this earth to intimidate you to violate your well-founded faith when it's sincere, coming from the heart, and just trying to establish your own honor and your own integrity in being part of the Creator. So I thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to all of your comments, shy of those that are blasphemous, rude, nasty, full of hate, and just wanting to exonerate yourself from blame. You see, when it comes to the world, we can't really blame anybody else for things that are taking place around us. All we can do is examine our own choices. So I thank you so much for your time, and may God bless.